Okay, so good afternoon, everyone. So welcome again to our, I think, fourth, no, session of our English general education. Okay, so before we start, let us do a sound check first. Can you please notify me if can you hear me? Am I loud and clear, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So the first additional topic that we will discuss for this afternoon will be figures of speech. Okay. So last session, I thought we were done. Okay. But not. I forgot that there's still two more topics that are very important. When you take left, when you take the left. Okay, so this is the figures of speech. A figure of speech is a word or phrase using figurative language, language that has other meaning than its normal definition. Okay, so when you construct a phrase or a text that contains figures of speech, it means that the meaning, okay, is not the literal meaning itself. Okay, just what it here, no, it says that it derives from its normal definition. Okay, so usually the figures of speech are used by writers when you write poems, books, okay, and if they want their literary pieces or text to be not so boring, okay, when someone reads it, okay? So that's the use of the figures of speech, okay? So now, let's move to the first figure of speech. The first one, we have the alliteration. The alliteration is just only the repetition of the beginning sounds of neighboring words. For example, she sells seashells, okay? So as you can observe here, the words in the sentence start with S, right? It starts with S, okay? So that's alliteration. It's just only the repetition of the beginning sounds, okay? But I'm not telling you, okay, it's not just literally letters, okay? Not only letters, but sounds, okay? Because there are times that the letter is different, but the sound are the same, okay? So I want to emphasize that one, okay? But anyway, most of the items in the test look like this, okay? So it starts with the same letter, okay? The first letter of each word is the same, okay? So that's it. Now, another example, we have Walter wondered where Winnie was. So the first sound is wuh, 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 right? So this one, blue baby bonnets bobbed through the bayou. So the beginning sound is, so they're the same, okay? The next figure of speech we have is the anaphora, okay? The anaphora is a technique where several phrases or verses begin with the same word or words. Okay. Okay, so sorry for that. Okay, so the anaphora is a technique where several phrases or verses begin with the same word or words. Okay, so the difference for between alliteration and anaphora is that anaphora starts with the same word or words. Okay, so for example, I came, I saw, I conquered. So the anaphora, okay, it is a technique, okay, where the words of, where each word, okay, in the sentence has the same or is the same, okay? So another here, mad world, mad kings, mad composition. So as you can see, the first word, okay, is the same. Okay, all are mad. Okay, mad, mad, mad. So that's it. Okay, so another we have, it was the best of times, it was the worst of times, it was the age of wisdom, it was the age of foolishness. So what do you observe in the third sentence? Can you tell me what is the first word? Can anyone tell me what is the first word? Okay. Here in the third sentence.
It was the.
Very good. So it was the. Okay. So that is an example of anaphora. Okay. Now the third one we have the assonance. Okay. Assonance is the repetition of vowel sounds, okay, in words that are close together. The sounds don't have to be at the beginning of the word, okay? So vowel sounds. Example we have here. A, okay, so the vowel sound here that repeats most often is A. So for example, for the rare and radiant maiden whom the angels named Lenore. Okay, so as you can observe, the vowel sound, okay, that repeats most often is the A sound. Okay, so another clue also on that is that the letter A appears most often or most of the time in each word in the sentence, right? Okay, so here, rare, there's A, and there's A, radiant, there are two A's, maiden, there's one A. So that's it, okay? So that is assonance, okay? So there are already three figures of speech that we've tackled. We have the alliteration, the anaphora, and the assonance. Okay, the next we have the euphemism. Euphemism is a mild, indirect, or vague term that often substitutes a harsh, blunt, or offensive term. Okay, you use euphemism because you want a harsh, okay, you want a harsh meaning to become less harsh, okay, or less blunt or less offensive. Example, a little thin on top instead of going bald. Another example, we have fell off the back of a truck instead of stolen. Okay, letting you go instead of firing you. Passed away instead of died. Economical with the truth instead of liar. Okay, so that is euphemism. Okay, you are using a less harsh text or sentence instead of saying the offensive term. Okay, that's euphemism. Okay, so that's euphemism. Okay, another we have the hyperbole. Hyperbole, it's very easy. It's one of the basic figures of speech. Okay, so hyperbole, of course, uses exaggeration for emphasis or effect. Okay, for example, I've told you to stop 1,000 times. That must have cost $1 billion. I could do this forever. She's older than dirt. Everybody knows that. So those are examples of hyperbole. Okay, exaggerating the text. Okay, exaggerating the meaning. Okay, so that's it. Hyperbole. Then we also have the irony. Occurs when there's a marked contrast between what is said and what is meant, or between appearance and reality. Oh, so that's irony. Okay. It's the contrast between what is said. Okay. For example, how nice. No? She said here, how nice. She said when I told her I had to work all weekend. Okay. So instead of saying, oh, that's so tiring, she said, how nice. Okay. So that's irony. You are telling the contrast. Okay. And we also have the metaphor. Metaphor is just a direct comparison. Okay. You are just comparing two things directly. So when we say directly, you are not using like or as like as or as. Okay. So that's metaphor. For example, of course, the famous example for metaphor is you are the apple of my eyes. Okay, you are okay. You are gold. Okay, for me you are gold. You are important. Okay, so those are examples of metaphor. Okay. Then we have here the onomatopoeia. Onomatopoeia is a term for a word that sounds like what it is describing. So this is very simple. Okay, for example, whoosh, splat, buzz, click, oink. So the sounds, okay, of what you are describing. So that's onomatopoeia. Then we have oxymoron. Oxymoron is two contradictory terms used together. Okay, so for oxymoron, the difference here is that later I will tell you the difference of oxymoron and the other figure of speech. Okay, in oxymoron, contradictory terms used together. Okay, so two words beside each other. Okay, so that's oxymoron. For example, peace, force, kosher ham, jumbo shrimp, sweet sorrow, free market. Okay, so that's an example of those are examples of oxymoron. Okay, okay, so two words, okay, that are beside each other in a sentence which are contradictory to each other. Okay, so that's oxymoron. Then we have personification. Personification gives human qualities to non-living things or ideas. You are personifying a non-living thing. Okay, you are giving life. Okay, you are giving life to a non-living thing. For example, the flowers nodded, the snowflakes danced, the thunder grumbled, the fog crept in, the wind howled. Okay, so those are examples of personification. So it's very easy. Okay, and we also have simile. Okay, so it's very simple. It's just the use of like or as. Okay, comparing things with the use of like and as. Okay, so it's very simple. Then we also have the synecdoche. Okay. Synecdoche occurs when part is represented by the whole, okay, Or conversely, the whole is represented by the part. Okay. Example, in a sentence, you should use wheels. No? And wheels represent car. For example, I bought yesterday two new wheels. Okay, so it means you bought two cars. Okay, then we have the police for one policeman, plastic for credit cards, Coke for any cola drink, hired hand for workers. Okay, so for example, the eight feet arrived at the airport today. So when we say 8 feet, it means how many people? Do you have any idea? When you say 8 feet arrived at the airport today, so there are how many people? How many people are there? 8 feet arrived at the airport today. So how many people are there? How many people arrived at the airport? Is it eight? Is it eight? Are you sure? How many feet are there? Okay, in one person, there are only two, right? Okay. If you okay, very good. So there are four people arrived at the airport today. How about this one? 10 eyes are looking at me. So how many people are looking at you? When I say 10 eyes are looking at me.
Five people.
So those are examples of synecdoche. Okay. This one, the last one, we have the metonymy. Okay. Metonymy is a word or phrase that is used to represent something related to bigger meaning. For example, fleets are sometimes described as being 30 sails strong. Okay, so a word or a phrase is used, okay, to describe a bigger picture. For example, you said, I am loyal to the crown. Okay, I am loyal to the crown. It means that you are loyal to the what? When you say, I am loyal to the crown. So what does it mean?
To the king and queen or to the government.
Okay, very good. You are loyal to the government, to the king or queen. Right? So, okay, very good. So that's an example of metonymy. Okay, so a phrase or a word is used to represent something bigger. Okay, so another, we have the White House, which represents the office of the president of in the U.S. Suits for business people, heart to refer to love or emotion, dish for the entire plate or food, Washington to refer to the U.S. government. Okay, so these are just examples. In Silicon Valley, Hollywood to refer to the film industry, ears for giving attention and listening, silver fox, hand, tongue, used in place of language. Okay, so these are just examples of metonymy. So there are a lot of it. Okay, you can just search it over the internet. Okay, so though there are a lot of figures of speech, okay, but I just chose the simple ones. Okay, because in Gen Ed, they're not going to use the difficult figures of speech, okay? Difficult to understand. They will just use the basic figures of speech. For example, simile, metaphor, hyperbole, personification. So they will most likely include that in the test. Okay, the simple, the basic one, especially if you are a high school or you have a specialization, diba? When you are a high secondary, your gen ed is only how many percent? I think 20, right? 20%. So it's very easy. Okay. So this ones, that's why I chose these figures of speech because these are most likely to be in the test. Okay, but anyway, I will send you a copy of this one. Okay, so no need to worry. So aside from that, but if you want to study more, okay, because actually there are more than 20 figures of speech, the English language. Okay, you can also look for it over the internet. Okay. Because these are also very helpful when you teach English soon. Okay, so that's all about the figures of speech. Now let's go to the word stress rules. Okay. So when we say stress, it means it is where. Okay, it is the syllable. Okay. It is a syllable in the word where you will give emphasis when you say it. Okay, that's stress. Okay, word stress rules. Okay, so the first rule, we have the two syllable nouns and adjectives. So where do you put stress? Okay, you put the stress on the first syllable. Okay, if it's a two syllable nouns and adjectives, you put the stress on the first syllable. For example, samples, purple, rainy, China, happy. Okay, so you put the stress on the first syllable. How about you? Can you give an example for that? Can you give an example? Two syllable nouns and adjectives. Okay, if you want, if you are shy, you can just put your answer on the chat box. If you are shy to talk, you can just put your answer on the chat box. And I will be the one to read your answer. Okay. So number two, we have the two syllable verbs and prepositions. So where do you put the stress? In most two syllable verbs and prepositions, the stress is on the second syllable. Okay. So if it's for verb and prepositions, so you put the stress on the second syllable. For example, relax, receive, direct, among. Okay. So that's it. Then, for the three syllable words, look at the word ending, okay, using the following as your guide. Okay, so here, if it's three syllables, okay, so for three syllable words ending with the suffixes er and li, the stress is placed on the first syllable. Okay, so for example, these words, as you can see, these words are three syllables, and each word ends with li and er, okay? So, orderly. So, you will put the stress on the first syllable, okay? Orderly, silently, lovingly. So, you put the stress when you say it on the first syllable, okay? So, I want you to remember the rules, okay? Because most of the time, this will be included in the test. Okay. So that's it. So can you give me an example for this one? If you want, you can just send your answer through the chat box. Okay, so next we have words ending, okay? So we are still on three syllables, okay? So words ending in consonants and in Y, okay? If there is a word that ends in a consonant, okay, or in a AY, or in a Y, sorry, then the first syllable usually gets the stress, okay? This rule also applies to words with four syllables, okay? I wanted to remember that one. Okay, so for example, we have rarity, optimal, gradient, generous. This one is generous. Then we have here words with various endings, okay? So take a good look at the list of suffixes below. The stress is going to be on the syllable right before the suffix, okay? So for example, able, okay, the suffix is able. So you put the, you put the stress before the suffix, the syllable before the suffix, okay? For example, addable, durable, laughable, okay? So that's it. All right, for example here, the word civilian has three syllables, okay? But the stress is put on the second, okay, syllable, because that's the syllable before the suffix, okay? So please remember that one. Okay, here, words ending in these sounds, okay? Or the suffixes. Okay, so when where do you put the stress? Okay, so here words that use the suffix aid, e, is, ear, k, it, or un have the primary stress actually placed on the suffix. Okay, so you put the stress on the suffix itself. For example, lemonade, crusade, arcade. Okay, agree, jamboree, guarantee, sightseer, puppeteer, Siamese, Japanese, cheese. So those are examples. Okay, for eight, we have stress on the second from the end syllable. Okay, you put the stress on the second syllable from the end of the word with words ending in action and shun. Okay, so here iconic, graphic, hypertension. Okay, so second to the last. Okay, here stress on the third from end syllable. You put stress on the third from end syllable with words that end in this one: cy, ty, phy, G-Y and A-L, okay? You put the stress on the third, okay? From the end syllable. For example, democracy, so the third from the end, okay? This is the first, last syllable, second to the last, and the third to the last. So more, democracy, okay? Geography, allergy, okay? So that's it. Word stress for compound words. For compound words, it's very easy. Of course, you put the stress on the first word. Okay, seafood, Iceland. Okay. So how about you? Can you give me an example of a compound word? Can you give me an example of a compound word?
Blackboard.
Okay, very good. Blackboard. So when you say the word blackboard, you put the stress on the word black. Okay, you say blackboard. Okay, so that's it. So for compound adjectives, okay, when we say compound adjectives, it's an made of at least two words. Okay? Usually when we say compound adjectives, it has hyphen. Okay, it's hyphenated. Okay, so often hyphens are used in compound adjectives. In compound adjectives, the most stress is placed in the stressed syllable of the second word. Okay, so it's the first syllable of the second word. Okay, so this is that is where you put the stress. Okay, so for compound verbs, okay, the stress is on the second or on the last part. Okay, so for example, detest, resist. Okay, but for this one, it's not a compound verb, right? It's just one word. So here we have the noun and compound nouns. For non-compound nouns are two-word compound nouns. A noun plus compound noun, the stress is on the first word. So same as the compound word. For example, board member, project manager, airplane mechanic. Also the first. Then we have proper nouns, are specific names of people, places, or things. For example, Jennifer, Spain, Google. The second word is always the one that takes the stress. For example, North Dakota, Mr. Smith, Apple Incorporated. Okay, so if it's two compound nouns, so the second noun. So let's see. Okay. Reflexive pronouns, it's the self or selves. We put the stress on self and selves. Okay. For numbers, the stress, if the number is a multiple of 10, the stress is placed on the first syllable. Okay, so 10, 50, 100. So that's it. So that's all for stress. So I hope you took note, okay, of the important things about these topics. But anyway, I'll send you a copy of this one. Okay, so no need to worry. Okay, so that's all. Okay, so that's the end, okay, of the English Gen Ed. Okay, so now let's move to the rationalization of the test. Okay, so let's move on to the rationalization of. Before we proceed, now do you have any question about this one? Or question about our previous lessons? Do you have any question? No question at all. So let me see the participants for this afternoon. So same as the participants last session. Okay, so it seems that there are no questions. So let's proceed to the next. Okay, the rationalization of the test.